Thank you. It's great to be here. So first of all, I would like to know as well, who are you? So who's the founder actually? Okay. And who's in working with product or is a product manager or whatever? Okay. So the rest is a customer maybe? Or going like customer success or sales? Okay. Very good. So it's good to get an understanding because, yeah, as a product manager, you always have to work with all the departments and just try to be the interface and try to manage all in between all the departments on what to do and how to do. I want to give you some of our or some of my insights that I gained over the years. So it's just some best practices that you can get inspired by or maybe not. The reason why I'm talking about this topic is when you want to enable your team, it needs a lot of trust in yourself and in your team. And that's something that where I was coming from a very much a top-down company formerly, so where the product manager was the guru and had to define everything very detailed, perfectly fine, and there was no questioning of this decision. And this was very problematic because people started to leave the company, especially the more creative ones, and actually the best ones. But in the end, we had not been very quick with this approach. And I'm, as a product manager, was all the time totally stressed because there was just so many things I had to think about. But today I want to tell you a bit more, what can you do to enable your team to take over a lot of your responsibilities that you actually have, so that they actually are able to be quicker, better, and more motivated. Okay, so hi, I'm Richard. I started as a trainee in a company for mobile games and browser games. It was Big Farm at the time. Then I was founding LGBTIQ network in the company, which I was very happy about. There were 30 members that met regularly. Then I became a junior product manager for Empire Four Kingdoms. You might have heard it. In 2015, it even got a prize for being the most annoying app that's making commercials, because in Germany, it was massively present on all TV channels. And it is actually up to today the most successful app that was ever developed by a German developer. The Big Farm and Empire for Kingdoms both made more than 100 million revenue. I tried to follow up with the success of Empire for Kingdoms, where I was used to a very much top-down approach. But then we started to have some change process towards a more agile way of doing things. And I was trying out for the first time as a product lead for Legends of Honor, which was the successor for Empire for Kingdoms, how to do this. And now as a head of product, I'm still using this and I will tell you some of the my insights or how we do things. So first of all, my production principles, this is what I would tell them, my team, and present to them sometimes again, that we never forget that the product is just nothing else but a solution for a user problem. So you need to find out which is the problem, of course, but this is something that you cannot do on your own. This is something that you will do with your team as well. And when you have an issue, when you have an open discussion, when you have some struggles, then just think about and give this as well to your team. Okay, so is this discussion helping us in delivering as much user value as possible? If not, then try to skip the discussion. Try to make a quick decision, because the only thing is that you will be able to deliver something new. Same the cost-benefit-oriented decision making. It's something that not only me should do. You should teach your team to be able to think about, okay, what is really actually a lot of effort? And please tell me if it's really a lot of effort, so we can make a decision which is easier for you to handle. So a lot of the discussion that I had about the new features, when I'm presenting this or when I'm looking over this with the designer and with one of the devs, We get the feedback, okay, that's actually something big, that's something very small, and then we can say, okay, then let's do it completely different. And in those sessions, we had reworking a lot of features to be more simple and quicker to develop. So as the same that you should do as well is presenting and discussing. I've found out that it's really important not to only talk about the positive things that you find, but as well about the uncertainties that you have. So you don't need to have the perfect plan and to say, okay, this is the perfectly worked out roadmap and the feature list. It is okay to say, okay, I'm uncertain here. What could we do? And then you can discuss this with your team, and the team can come up with solutions as well. This can happen for the customer success, sales, developers, designers. And always demand and appreciate feedback. So today at Loopline, I'm working on a system for making feedback easier to manage and to give and to receive for employees. So I really take this very serious to demand and appreciate feedback on everything that you do. Something very interesting with the the teams which are working together with the directly with the customer for some customer success and sales. They formerly I had. Every time, every day, I got a lot of emails and feature requests from customer success that said, okay, we need this, we need this, we need this, we need this. Come on, you can't handle all this, and you have to reply to all of this, and you don't actually know, is this something that you really need, or is it something that you just heard once that you would like to have? What we started doing was that we said, okay, the team can prioritize on their own what they think, how important this one request is in regard to all the requests that they already have given to you. So let's say, okay, there comes in a feature, I need this functionality, and it's I think it's very important. That's what the customer said. Then the sales colleague thinks, okay, is it actually something that's really important for this one customer or not? And then they can give it priority points from we used 1 to 5, and we agreed on a matrix on what to do with which priority. So for 5, it's very clear we need to do something now. Actually, when it's a 5, it's not receiving. You will not receive this as an email, because usually then the agent is standing just next to you because something is really burning, like I can't log in or data is lost or something. For the 3 and number 4, these are the ones that come in and you say, okay, I can take some time to think about them. They are very useful and they are something that they say we really should do. And then you can agree on some service level agreements, for example, to say, okay, a 4 we should do within 3 months, while a number 3 maybe in the next 6 months. And what I like most of this is number 2 and number 1. Because number 2 and number 1, we probably won't do them. Because when you say they are actually quite not important, why should we develop them? Sometimes they just try to forward me everything that they received and said, okay, Richard should make sense out of it. But by having them prioritizing on what they think, what do you think would happen to the 2s and the 1? I just received less mails because they said, okay, it's a 2 or it's a 1. Richard is not going to do it anyway, so I will just forget about it. And this is really nice because you don't have to keep the organization busy with tiny requests which are actually not delivering value. And this was the matrix. The teams, they started to really develop out this matrix and make it more complex so everybody knows, okay, it is a 4 if this applies, if this does not apply, then it's a number 3 only. And they really went into this, making this thing big. It just shows that's one part where you say, okay, I don't need to be the one that is deciding everything. Give it into the hands of the team. Let them give a prioritization on this, and everybody is way more motivated and you really can concentrate on the things which are important, which are the fives and the fours. And then you can make a priority of the departments themselves. So you can say maybe sales is more important than customer success. And what they did is they gave it a number, and then they so technically how we did it, there was an email address, and you can just send your request or the forwarded request that they had sent to this email. It was feature request at. And then it was a card in Trello, and as they put in the title, the customer success or sales priority points, they then said, okay, four other customers wanted this as well. It's a useful thing for them and us. That's a bit quick. Yeah. One thing that we do, like many of you probably do, is having a daily meeting in Scrum. It's important to be daily, I've heard, but yeah, the developers really don't like meetings so much, and they complained all the time, and we found out, especially in one of the retrospectives I will show you in a second, that this is really an issue for them, and they don't want this meeting to happen every day. So you say, okay, then let's do the daily meetup, the daily stand-up, just three times a week maximum. And I have to say that it's still working very good, because when you trust your team, you don't have to come together every day. So everything that you heard from Scrum or from any logic to of system to manage a team, you should try to apply to what you really need and you think that your team needs. And when your team says, we don't need it on a daily basis, then you say, okay, it's your meeting, because you need to figure out what blocks you, what are you working on, and how can we help you with that. And if this is enough not to have on a daily basis, that's fine. Reviews is another part of Scrum. It's usually the product manager being the boss, sitting in the meeting, everybody's preparing everything what they did in the last sprint, and showing, wow, that's the features, and this is how they work. And you then, at the end, you're happy because everything is really as you had in mind, or you're not, and then everybody's depressed. What we started doing, and I really like it a lot, is that we do, instead of these big meetings, we have small ad hoc meetings. So when a developer says, I'm ready with this one feature, then says, oh, please designer, come over, maybe the QA agent as well, and says, let's have a look at it. And as I'm trusting my designer, I'm perfectly fine if the designer says it's okay, the QA agent says it's okay because they read the specs, and then you can say, okay, the feature can go live. And I'm really doing this without checking it in a big meeting. Of course, I'm looking at the test server as well, but nothing happened. Nothing bad happened. So you as a product manager, you don't have to be the blocking part for the update. If something really bad would happen, we could probably solve this very quickly within one day anyways. But this is something that where I said, okay, don't be the blocker. Trust your team that they will be able to be responsible and develop the feature as it was expected to be. There's one thing that I actually liked in the old way of doing those meetings is that customer success and sales, they really need to know, okay, what feature do we have, which is going live, and how does it look like exactly? Something that I haven't completely solved yet, so that's not completely satisfying, because I'm having weekly meetings with them, explaining what's all on the roadmap and how does it look like. But it was nice beforehand, because I had those teams as well in the big reviews. The last meeting that you have in Scrum is a retrospective meeting. I found this is actually very very important one, because it is not about what we did; it is about how we work together and how we are collaborating. What I'm doing here is to say on a four-week space, you look at the start-stop-continue approach, What should we begin doing? What should we not do anymore? And what should we continue doing because it works well? At the beginning, those meetings took more than 1 hour. This meeting, this is the result of a meeting that I had this year, this week, and it took actually less than 30 minutes because we already found so many things that we started in the past and which we stopped in the past that we are mostly on the continuous side. That's awesome. That's a great result. And everybody's happy, as you can see as well, because they say, on a scale from 1 to 5, how happy are you or have you been in the last weeks? And you will get some kind of a quantitative idea of how your team is feeling and doing. Most of them gave 4.5 points or stars. In the beginning, we said, no, it needs to be full stars. 4 or 5, make a decision. But in the end, okay, if everybody wants to give 4.5, then it's all fine as well. And team was so happy that they even started playing XXO on it. Just giving you some examples of what they could put in there. For stop is having less interruptions. That's especially they did not only mean interruptions while they are working as well. Things like when a spec is changing and something they're working on at the moment, a feature. And things that they liked was, for example, pair programming. So there was one guy writing it down and then the others made another line to say, yes, I support this idea. So it looks a bit like laziness at the beginning because one is working and the other one is just looking at it. But it improves quality a lot. And in the end, speed as well, because when you need to maintain less complicated code, it's easier for in the future. And everybody was very happy about the specs, but just one said, okay, specs came a bit late. This wasn't an example for a new MVP that we are about to launch just next month. Okay. So what about the rest of all the Scrum stuff? So we don't really have sprints, so I don't need to have a sprint planning. Happy about this. Still, we're having some milestones or MVP goals. So we said, okay, this is what we want to achieve. And how do we organize our process to push features live? When features are ready, shortly before they go into the QA, then we say, okay, let's bundle these features to go live together. So we don't say, I cannot say to customer success, in 3 weeks, we will launch this feature. But we are quicker because I can say within 3 weeks, or maybe even 2, this feature will go live. And only big features will go solo just to reduce the risk of a failure or of a bug that you come up with. Yeah, probably you have seen this. It's quite old. It's the swing tree. There's many examples of them. Sometimes it's a tire in a tree as well. What is interesting is, yeah, you try to figure out what you actually want to build, but in the end, everybody's understanding something quite differently, and everybody is having other requirements. I put in here what the salesman promised because they said actually, well, okay, a swing should actually have even a roof and a bell so you can write directly a message to us and nearly to the product manager directly to say, okay, this is my feature request and it's important. And you should be able to sit very relaxed. But in the end, what the customer really wanted was this tire. There's a lot more to discuss here because why should the customer really already want a tire in there? Maybe they want actually something completely different. So let me just put together what I found out was helping to work better with my team. Let the team evaluate cost benefit, so they should be able to say, okay, this is something big, this is something small, so this is how we should do it. let the team take over as much responsibility as possible, like prioritizing features, like being the ones that are doing the review instead of being always a product manager. And as well, let the team descope features, which means it goes into the cost-benefit direction. If there's something, if there's a request, which is, if there's a feature that we actually want to do, maybe we can make it somehow a bit easier or smaller or simpler. And then I would be happy to have a Q&A session and to discuss with you about your experiences with your teams and how to empower your team. Thank you.
Basically, you have mentioned that you haven't solved yet till the end the problem of informing customer happiness about the upcoming features. Could you share the approaches that you have tried and they didn't work the way how you wanted and why basically?
Yeah, so the issue is, okay, you want to be, of course, the customer success team needs to know which features are there, because if they get a request, then they need to be able to reply. So that's the basic thing that they need. Still, you don't want to micromanage everything and want to say, okay, on this specific day, this feature goes live, because it will be quicker when the team is taking over some of this responsibility. So what we do is we sit together, we look at the roadmap, so they know about the roadmap and about the features which are upcoming in the next weeks. And of course, when there is a feature which is really changing things for the customer, which are maybe having even a negative impact, then we try to find a release date for this specific feature, so that they have more time to inform the users of writable log article, for example. So this is one solution to say, okay, the ones which are really making bigger impacts and changes need to get scheduled. But then it is about this the steady communication of in the weekly meeting, and as well you can involve them, and this is something what we sometimes do, involve them in the stand up so that they are there as well, which involves them as well into where we are standing, what are we are working on, where we're developing. So I wouldn't say that a stand up, for example, is exclusively for IT.
While I was scribbling what you just said, I see the starting page of your presentation. It says, don't hire product managers, enable your team. So was it a transition in your organization that the product managers transitioned somewhere else, or you even got rid of them?
I wouldn't say you should get rid of them. Google was trying out to get rid of all their middle managers in 2012. They wrote a nice article, or they even have a complete page, which is called Rework. What you should do is, I came from a company with 1,200 employees, and product managers were like gods. No decision was made without the product manager. Everybody was, oh, when the product manager's in the room, then it was like, wow, that seems to be an important meeting. And it was very much top down. So I have to say, I was learning from one of those product managers who then became as well ahead. And he was a complete guru. So he knew really about everything, and he was able to completely micro-control everything. But what's happened is people were not satisfied with this, because when you can't discuss about how a feature should look like, how it should work, or how it should feel for the user, then you start thinking, okay, that's maybe not the right place for me to work. And especially our designers, they really left soon after they started. Just the ones which had been very, they just obeyed, but they were not the best ones. And we had a transition in our company, so we hired a lot of agile coaches, and I was in the change management team for our studio, which was 180 people. And the plan was to change towards a more enabled teams in all the studio within the 1.5 years time frame. So you can see that there that it's a process which costs a lot of time, and it takes a lot of time as well to build up the trust. And you not only you as a product manager need to trust your team, your managers as well, or your CEO needs to trust in you as a product manager that it's okay that your team is taking over this responsibility, doing the prioritizing, doing actually some kind of your job. And this is a this is something that takes time to. But that's why I'm showing this, because I can say that it worked already in two teams very nicely, and that's the only thing you can do. Always show good examples of that it can work. I would say so, yeah. And my vision in the old company was even to get my position completely redundant. Doesn't work in my smaller organization now, but. In the end, I would say that's what you should do. Hey.